Welcome to Visual Studio 2022 for C++ developers. My name is Cy Brand, I'm the team's C++ developer advocate, and today I'm going to show you why you should upgrade if you're a C++ developer. Now, before I get started, the mission of the C++ team here is to make the lives of all C++ developers on the planet better, and that comes with a bunch of different facets to it. We participate in the standards, we drive our own proposals, we help others with theirs, we prototype proposals. We invest in our toolchain, our compiler and libraries. We bring them up to the latest standard. We improve their performance and their security. We simplify dependency management with VC Package, which is an open source package manager. We improve the Visual Studio IDE to make it the most productive experience that we can. And then we continue to enhance the C++ experience for Visual Studio Code as well. But today we're going to focus on 2 and 4, our toolchain and the IDE. And on the IDE front, one thing you might have heard a lot today is Visual Studio 2022 is 64-bit. And the C++ team have made sure that this transition can be as smooth as possible. So a few things you'll notice is the new projects are going to target 64-bit by default. And if you have these kind of huge projects, which previously you might have struggled with memory usage, should be less of a problem now. And we do want to make that upgrade as pain-free as possible. So you can install the 2015, 17, and 19 toolsets directly from the installer in 2022 just by clicking those buttons. And you can even install minor toolsets side by side as well. If you have binary dependencies, which you can't necessarily recompile, we are guaranteeing binary compatibility back to 2015. So if you have those dependencies, you can still upgrade to the latest toolset. If you have open source dependencies, then you could potentially use VC Package to upgrade to the new toolset for those. If you'd like to know more about porting and upgrading specifically, you can check out aka.ms/cpp/upgrade. Now, a few other reasons you might want to upgrade. Hot Reload is a new feature in 2022 and has support for C++. So this lets you apply code changes without stopping at a breakpoint or restarting your application. It injects your changes into the app dynamically and doesn't trigger a full rebuild of your project. This is super useful if you're developing an interactive application, like a video game, for example, where you might want to make a change and immediately see this reflected in the running program without having to stop or recompile. You can even click this little button on the right here to hot reload on file save. If you'd like to know more about hot reload, you can check out aka.ms/hot-reload-cpp. We also want to make sure that Visual Studio is the best choice for if you're developing on Windows, but targeting any platform, not just Windows. And part of that is WSL2 support. So this allows you to build and debug C++ code on WSL2 distributions without having to set up an SSH connection. And it has support for both CMake and MS Build. We would recommend CMake if you're doing open source development, but MS Build support is there as well. And if you'd like to know more details, you can check out cpp-wsl2. And then we also have experimental support for Lib Fuzzer. Lib Fuzzer is an in-process coverage guided evolutionary fuzzing engine from the LLVM project. So if you're wanting to fuzz your APIs in order to guarantee their correctness and security, then you can use this. It's now available in VS 2022, and you pass fsanitize equals fuzzer. If you'd like to know more, you can check out aka.ms/cpp/libfuzzer. Now, if you can upgrade your IDE, that's great. If you can upgrade your standard of C++ as well, that's even better. So where we are with C++ conformance right now is all stable C++ 20 features have been completed. There are a few defect reports which came in late. They're kind of like bug reports to the standard. They came in late in the process, so we're still dealing with those. But all stable C++ 20 features are now available under std C++ 20 switch. So we guarantee that these are ABI stable and they're production ready. We also have some C++ 23 features, all of which have actually been contributed by all of you folks to our open source standard library, so that's great. Coming next, we are focusing a lot on standard library modules and coroutines, both the proposals going through the standard and implementing them in our tools. On the STL specifically, we have 115 C++ 20 features completed, and a bunch of those have been contributed by you, so thank you so much for all of that. You can see the graph here for C++ 20 features. You can see the little bump at the end is those defect reports coming in. But we're starting to get all of these back down again. You can check out the most recent data at microsoft.github.io/STL. Now I'm going to demonstrate the four main features of C++ 20 all working together in tandem. Okay, so I'm going to create a new project, an MS Build application, and I'll call it Launch. So this gives me a new project. I want to show ranges, modules, coroutines, and concepts all working together. So I'm going to show a little random number generation example. So I'm going to get a bunch of random numbers. Random numbers helps if I can type. And I'm going to get these from something called launch XOR shift. XOR shift is a specific random number generation algorithm, which is implementable in about 5 lines of code and actually generates pretty decent random numbers. Of course, we need to seed it with some high quality seed like 4, and then we can say loop through all of them, random numbers, and print them all out with a new line. Okay, so this is what basic usage is going to look like, and now we can think about how to actually implement this. Now, I want to use modules and coroutines for this, so first thing I need to do is go into my project properties, go to general and language standard. Flip this from 14 to C++ latest. Okay, now I'm going to create a new module. Add to my source files a new module. This will create a C++ module interface unit, which you can see has the extension IXX, and we're going to call it XOR shift. All right, this gives us a couple of lines. We have module XOR shift, which says from here down, everything belongs to the module XOR shift. Additionally, export this and make it available to external code. Then we have a single function called myfunc, which is also exported. If we got rid of this, then myfunc would not be visible to external code. This is one of the benefits of modules. Apart from improvements on build times, you can hide implementation details of your code without having them leak into contexts that you don't want them. But we don't want this. We wanted namespace launch. And if we want to export everything in here, we can just say export. Okay, so now we can think about implementing XOR shift. We want this to be an infinite stream of random numbers. But for now, let's just implement it as a single iteration of the algorithm. So we'll return a std uint 6040. Our function will be called XOR shift, and we will take a uint 6040 as an argument. So uint 6040 is in the cstd int header. Just to show you something first, say I put it here. This might look fine, but remember I said that module XOR shift means everything below here belongs to this module. Hash include means just take everything from this header and dump it into this file. So we're saying that everything in here is going to get module linkage, and we're going to get some build issues with that. So this is actually wrong. Like if we had an import of some module here, then this would all be fine. Modules are designed to handle that. But for regular hash includes, we want to stick them up in what's called the global module fragment, which we introduced like this. Just something to be aware of. Okay, so the IntelliSense found this, and we're all good to go. So we can implement XOR shift like so. We take our seed, we XOR it with the result of right shifting by 13, then left shifting by 17, and then right shifting by 7. The very definition of magic numbers. Don't ask me how they got these. And then we return the seed. Okay, so this is a single iteration of the XOR shift algorithm. But we wanted this to be infinite. Unfortunately, I don't have infinite memory on this laptop, so we're going to have to generate these on the fly. And one way we can do that is using coroutines. So coroutines are essentially a generalization of a subroutine or regular function. A subroutine will enter up here at the top. It will exit at return statements or flowing off the end of control flow. One entry, some exit point. A coroutine instead can pause or suspend during execution and then be resumed later. And one of the ways to do that is using coyield, which generally means pause execution, send this back to the caller, and then we can be resumed later. So we're going to stick this in an infinite loop. And now we're getting build errors because we haven't included coroutine traits. But there's something more here. Coyield doesn't actually have built-in behavior. You have to kind of tell the compiler what coyield should mean for this specific coroutine. And the way you do that is customizing the return type here. So we want like a kind of Python style generator here. Unfortunately, there's no generator type in the standard library for C++ 20. There should be in C++ 23. But we could use an open source implementation. I have one myself called TL Generator. But if we try this, we get build errors because I don't have TL Generator installed. It's open source, so I could use VC Package for it. I do have VC Package installed on this system, so I could just install TL Generator from the command line, but I want to show you manifest files. So manifest file is kind of similar to like if you've used NPM for JavaScript or Cargo for Rust, where we declaratively say things about our dependencies and our package. So we have a name, I'm going to call it launch, we have a version, string, going to do 1.0, and then we have dependencies. And this is a list of dependencies. You could optionally put versions here or minimum versions, there's a bunch you can do, but for now I'm just going to say TL generator. And there's a package or a port in VC package, which tells it how to download and build and install this library. So if I save this to the root of my directory in vcpackage.json, then the last thing I need to do to get this to work is to go to my project properties, configuration, VC package, use VC package manifest, yes. This will tell the build system to pick up the manifest file. So now if I build my solution, we should see this happening. Now, the first thing which happens before VC package is MSBuild scans the sources for module dependencies. So you do not have to tell MSBuild the order in which your modules have to be built. It will work it out by itself. We don't have this for CMake yet, but we are working on it with Kitware. So after the module dependencies were scanned, then VC package ran, and you can see that it installed TL generator. It also installed a couple of transitive dependencies, which TL generator has. And it even used some cache binary packages, which I already had on my system, which is pretty handy. And it told us, you know, if we're using CMake, then we could just copy paste these in, edit them slightly. And then we got a bunch of build errors because we haven't finished yet. But that should be enough to come up here and say include TL. And it found the installation. This is a local installation. This is not going to affect any other projects in our system. TL/generator. And IntelliSense found the file. Great. So now we can go to launch, conclude that, and then import. And there we go. IntelliSense there found XorShift because it scanned for the dependencies. It knows what file it's in. So we can import XorShift, and now IntelliSense worked out this type and everything's fine. So we could run this. It would give us an infinite stream of random numbers. Let's say we want to reduce this infinite stream of random numbers a little bit. Say we want them to be in the range of 0 to 100. How could we do that? Well, one way would be with ranges. So we could say hash include ranges, and ranges are a way of essentially building up a pipeline of operations on ranges of data. One way we can do that is saying pipe this. This is kind of like a Unix pipe, like a bash style pipe. Pipe this into studviews colon colon, and now we get a list of all of the view adapters in the standard library which are available to us, and you could use your own or other ones which are open source. One thing to note is if you used Range V3, the precursor to all of this, and an older version of VS, then you probably found that IntelliSense really, really struggled. We've done a lot of work on this. You saw that that was pretty much instantaneous. So if I say I want to transform it, then IntelliSense works, says, okay, you need a function here. So we're going to pass it a lambda, which returns I mod 100, let's say. Okay, so now we can try running this, and we should get out an infinite stream of random numbers. Here we go, from 1 to 100. Great. Now, say we actually want to change this slightly and see it update in real time. I talked about hot reload earlier. I have hot reload on filesafe turned on. So if I go and change this to a larger number and save, then it will recompile while it's running and we see the change immediately. It's kind of cool. But say we don't want this to be infinite. We want this to be bounded. We could instead say pipe this again into studviews take and take the first 5, for instance. And this should print out, there we go, 5 random numbers. Couple last things, the usual kind of navigation experience you might expect for modules is all there. So if I control click on the module name, then it goes to the definition. Let's say I want to stick a breakpoint in here. This is a coroutine, so there's a bunch of compiler magic which is going on here. Like, this is kind of changed into a state machine and split up into different functions. But we make it all look like it's just regular code. So if we step over this coyield, like in this time, this coroutine has been suspended and then resumed, but we make it look like it's just going on, like a regular function. We even have a coroutine frame visualizer in case you're writing your own coroutines. So to recap, we saw modules with build system support and go-to modules. We saw coroutines with debugging support. We saw ranges with IntelliSense all working. And we kind of saw concepts. Concepts are what underlie ranges. So that's how we saw those working. To reiterate, the mission of our team is to make the lives of all C++ developers on the planet better through standards, through our toolchain, through VC package, through our VS IDE, and through the Visual Studio Code experience. If you'd like to know more about some of these, we do have a couple other talks today, one on game development and one on cross-platform development, so please do check those out. And other than that, I do hope you'll go away and upgrade to VS 2022 and let us know what you think. Thank you very much.